episode of the Ever Black podcast is brought to you by Death Wish Hot Rods and Customs. Check out their Instagram for all their new t-shirts, caps, beanies, cups, and the all-new Atomic Death lineup.
Hey, this is Trevor Sternad from the Black Dahlia Murder here, and you're listening to the Ever Black podcast.
Hey, human skull, this is odorous from Guam.
I'm going to battle Fear Factory.
This is George Gorge from Under Fisher.
This is Jasmine Double Drop.
This is Wade from Our Last Enemy.
This is Mike Nick from Suicidal Tendencies.
Hey, this is Wednesday 13.
This is Bruce Evans.
This is Rex from Kill Devil Hill.
This is Gary Boone from Sepultura, and you're listening to Ever Black podcast.
Pleasure's all mine. I'm excited to be here. There's so much going on today. I feel like I'm so energetic.
Stank facing.
Yeah. Ready. Straight up.
Yeah,
straight
man. Up. Awesome. So you're in New York, right?
Yes. Long Island, New York, born and raised.
There you go. So I've never been there. I just want to go get a photo with like the Ghostbusters, firehouse. Everyone's like, oh, no, that's it for me. Have you ever done that?
That's it. No, I haven't. I feel like, dude, it's so weird. I didn't even go to the Statue of Liberty until 2017.
There you go.
Like I didn't do anything in the city. I didn't do like the tours. You know what it is? Because when you live here, like I don't live in the city, right? So I live in Long Island. Like it takes me like a 40-minute train to get to the city. And when I'm in the city, I'm either drunk at a concert, preoccupied, like trying to get a good burger. Like that's all my focus is. But outside of that, yeah, there's not too much touristy stuff. There's so much to do here, but yeah. I think it's because there's so many tourists in those areas that for me, we're just like someday.
Nah. Someday. That's like it here too. We're the same.
Yeah, that's like me asking you, like, dude, how was it like petting a kangaroo? And then people are just like, I don't give a fuck about that.
We see him out on our driveway, and we're like, get the fuck out.
Yeah,
of here,
yeah. You're shooing them away. Meanwhile, I'd be like.
Yeah, that's right. Well, it's as I mentioned, it's awesome that you could join us on the show. The new Alluvial album. Did I say that right? I've never.
Nope.
Alluvial.
Alluvial.
Alluvial. See?
Yeah.
That's my Australian, or I'm just an idiot. Anyway, I've been saying it like that for months. But Sarcoma. Did I say that right?
Sarcoma. Yeah. Sarcoma. Right. It's where, you know, if some people put the punctuation or not the punctuation, the. See, I can't even get other words out. Who am I giving English lessons to, you know?
An Australian can't talk properly at 8 o'clock in the morning. But, you know, this thing is one of my absolute favorite albums in a very long time.
Appreciate it, man.
Man, considering everything that's been going on in the last 12 months, I think it's an incredible achievement. And word's really gotten out about it. Like, it's
weird. It's like amazing. It's like a wildfire right now. And I can't ask for a better thing. I posted on my Instagram story. All I thought about, me and the guys were in a group chat together. So we're just like sending each other screenshots. We're like, holy crap, right now we're like number 50 in all of iTunes. And then that was cool. And then an hour later, we're 26. And then an hour later, we're 11. And then right now in the States, if we were to open up iTunes and click on like top charts for metal, we're number one. And then like, here, hold on. This is the shit that I see. And I'm just kind of like not processing it correctly. Like here, I don't know if am I going to be on camera in the like,
yeah, yeah, you are. Yeah. Hang on.
So look at that list.
That's crazy, dude.
So first place is us and for the metal charts. And then second, there's another one in here where we are top in the rock charts. That was the metal charts before we go Gojira and all that stuff, but we passed Journey on this. Like, what are we talking about here? You know what I mean? Like, it's one of those things that we didn't expect to see waking up. You know, originally we were going to self-release this. Me and Wes were just like, you know, we don't know where it's going to go. It's a risk. It could go up. After the pandemic, we're just sitting here like, is this going to turn out the way we hope? You know, like we went into this very like lowballing ourselves, and now it's turning around tenfold for us, and we can't be happier.
It's a fucking monster.
Yeah.
That's what it is. And, you know, and I'm not just saying that, like I've been really digging it, and I know it's been done for a little while because I've been cranking it for a little while. I've been very lucky. But was it done before everything went to shit?
No, it was actually kind of during the shit that we got it all finished and together. Like, you know, there was a lot of back and forth with me and Wes. Wes was alone in the project back in like, you know, 2000. I left Suffo at the end of 2017. Yeah. I did a short window in Suffocation.
Yes.
And then I became a free agent. I remember looking around, you know, I was on my Facebook going through like friend requests that I had missed or messages. And I got a message, you know, just in the dark from Wes. We weren't really familiar of each other, but we had mutual friends that put us in touch. And then we were talking about it for like a good year and a half. And then it was kind of like, all right, let's give this a shot. Fly down here. He's in Georgia. I'm in New York. So I went down there. I demoed some songs and like it was just an instant bond. And then the tracking of the album really started. I think we were finished by the majority. Like we started in the beginning of 2019, like really planning and writing. And then we finished tracking probably mid last year. And because there was a moment where we thought we were done. And then that instrumental track, that had vocals on it. And we ended up canning the vocals because it like the whole album to us felt so good. And it was like, yeah, we really got that message out. And then that song came up and it was like just a sore thumb. Like it's just something there wasn't right about it. And we just scrapped the vocals on it and we re-recorded 40 because 40 was going to be our instrumental track.
Oh, well.
So then we went back and we're like, hey, let's try some of the ideas we had on this, but in here. And then that's where Wes was like, hey, I want to try something different too. I want to sing on this one. I was like, go for it. And it was just a whole roller coaster of like, okay, now this fits, you know? And I'm glad we spent the time and the pandemic really helped us kind of, I know it's shitty to say that pandemics help nobody, but it helped us like sit back and take our time on it where otherwise we may have self-released it. We may have rushed it in a way that we would not work in our favor like it did today.
It's a really dark, really, really dark fucking album too. Like,
yeah, there's a lot of themes.
Heavy, dude. It's like, where did it take you? I mean, was it the pandemic or what was it that got you in that space?
I'll be honest. Wes was a big driving force in the writing for this. And he wrote the majority of the stuff. I only helped with some pattern placements and some little ideas here and there and, you know, word choice and things like that. But like, really, the themes were really based around him and his experiences. Like, I'm thankful in this band to be in a band with people that also share such high experience. Like Matt, our drummer, is a robot. Literally just flying on the kit. And then Tim is like, he's a bassist, but like he's a great guitarist that took the role as a bassist. He played bass in Entheos, but like I've watched him and Wes just riff and they're playing the same shit. And I'm just like, damn, okay, this is going to be dope. And then, yeah, the moment everything came together for writing and stuff, Wes was really driving this album himself. And the experience came from, I guess where I was going with all that, I went down to work. My ADD is kicking right now.
Embrace it.
No, it was more the fact that Wes and everyone else in this band has all had like a glimpse of a time to shine kind of thing. And like, No one really got to hear Wes's story. He's always filled in for bands. He's played for bands. And like his writing never really even came to the surface. It was more the fact that he was just a hired gun all the time. And now in this band, he's got a really clean, clear microphone to say, hey, this is what I've experienced and this is what I feel. So like there's songs about his time in Iraq. There's songs about letting, you know, substance consume you. There's song about like Exponent is all about AI realizing that we are a heap of shit and we should be wiped out. Then, you know, every song has a really dark theme, which is kind of how we came up with the album title. We had one track called Sarcoma, which is the third track on the album. And that is, we were going to have the album be called When Sleepers Become, When Sleepers Become Giants. And I kind of suggested, I don't like mouthful album names. I like to be like, you know, if we all talk about a band we like Suffocation, for instance, Effigy of the Forgotten, it's a long name. Everybody calls it Effigy. Nobody sits there and says the whole thing.
Yeah, right.
We like to the point. We like to the point. And if you want it to stick and kind of be in your head, Sarcoma, boom. We know what we're talking about. There's no confusion there. And for me, that's just a visual OCD. But then talking about it, I was kind of like giving him this idea of every song on this album is like a metaphorical version of a cancer, something in your way, something running you in the dirt. You know, there's always like this, there's this dark, gloomy cloud in front of you. And I guess if there's a message to be taken away, it's passing through it and persevering, you know, and that's kind of how we feel as a band. We've all been in the mud as musicians, you know, everyone wants to pay you nothing and keep going on tour. And we're just kind of at a point where we're putting all of our efforts together, brutal death metal backgrounds, you know, technical backgrounds, prog backgrounds. And now we have this new sound that we are super stoked to show off. And it's working. It's coming back tenfold.
Oh, mate. Absolutely. Absolutely. You can see. I mean, look at those charts, brother. I mean, it's you've done the yards.
It doesn't make it to me. I'm just still like, how the hell, you know, like it's just silly, but I'm hoping to see it persevere there for the next few weeks because the names in there are just like, yeah, you know, Metallica Black Album was pretty good. You know, it's like, how are we even in that list? You know,
but is that where you recorded everything?
No, this is my bedroom, bro. This is my bed is there. That's my normal TV. Really? I watch. That's just, yeah. Like I run an HDMI throughout my whole room.
Wow.
So being that my camera's here, I don't want it just looking at like me. And then I used to have like a clothing rack here and it looked like I was in the back of a store. You know, it didn't look good. So I was just like, you know what, for the camera's sake, you know, I'll have friends over throughout the year and we'll do podcast stuff. Like, check this out. Ready? I have a sit and stand desk. So the whole station goes up and down. I'm standing right now.
It just makes you look like you're growing taller.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the setup I wish I had, but I look at, you can see mine. It's like a.
But you know what? If you got props, who cares, right? You got stuff to look at. I think the only thing you need is lighting. Like lighting is fun.
Hey, there you go. That's what I need, some mood lighting.
Yeah.
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 But where did you do it? I mean, where'd you record it?
At John Douglas's place. God, he's gonna kill me. What's the name of his studio? Victitious Studios? No, Visceral. Give me a second. I gotta give him the proper love. But yeah, John Douglas did it, and Jeff Dunn mixed it. Vorticist. I don't know if I'm saying that right. Vorticist. I don't know how to say that. I'm not going to try anymore. But anyway, he's awesome. John Douglas is like literally a genius on just watching him like work Pro Tools. If you're talking about an idea, he's like already like, oh, yeah, just track it. I'm like, no, but you got to move. He's like, I already moved it. Just go. I'm ready. It's like, okay, dude, I love this, you know?
I love people like that. They're just so, I've worked with one dude up here who was just just incredible. Studio,
he's a wizard.
He is, man. Yep. It's man, incredible. And they just go bang, 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 and you just go extra. And you know, you're not waiting for anyone. I love it.
Yeah, nothing, dude. And if anything, if we are waiting, if we're waiting, it's because something good is coming. Because he'll in 40 Stories, for instance, there's a moment in the song that like me and Wes were tracking, and like I know when Wes is in like work mode, it's very like, all right, let's just get it done. Let's just do this, and we'll wrap up at, you know, we got a certain time. We got to be out of here. And I'm like, wait, just can we try something? And I'll always throw in like a little something, like it may drop, it may not work. But like there was this one thing that worked real good. And when I was explaining it to Wes, I'm not like, I don't use musician terms. I use New Yorker asshole terms. And I'm just like, yeah, just stretch it. And it'll sound like a crispy, like tinny thing. I'm not using real music words. And he's like, I don't know what you're trying to tell me right now. He went out to take a piss break. And John understood me, and I was like, I want like this swell effect on like coming out of the lead on 40, and it's go. And there's a point where it's like, and it spreads out. And I was like, I want it to fill your head. I want it to feel like you think you hear it fine, and then it fucking separates around you. And he was like, all right, cool. I think I know what you're talking about. And Wes came back, put on the headphones, and didn't realize we changed it. But then when he listened to it, he's like, whoa, like what was that? I was like, that's what I was trying to say. Like, I love that. And he's like, all right, fuck yeah. And then, you know, that kind of energy just kept reoccurring in the studio, and it was such a blast.
Man, that's incredible. That's incredible. Yeah.
And shout out to John for also doing guest vocals on this album. He was if you listen to Putrid Sunrise, the gremlin, like high sounding guy, that's John. Because he had an idea. We were talking about the part and how it's like that whole song is very much like going through substances, and then when it dwells down, it's like the symbolism of like a hangover, and you're fucking cloudy, and there's that voice in your head. And we had this idea, and he's like, oh, well, it could sound like this. And he just did it, and we're like, cool, keep it on the track. Like, we don't need like a guest vocalist to come in and be from another band or be a clout thing. It's just, it sounds dope. Keep it. Good job.
That's awesome. That's awesome, man. Well, I mean, the band was an instrumental band prior to this.
But as always intended to have a vocalist, it just never happened. It was never like intended to just be that. But the fact that, you know, same idea we were talking about before with me and Wes almost jumped the gun. That was one of those experiences where they were like, hey, we got an offer. Let's do a tour. Let's open up. Let's get the word out this way. And they went with it. And then they had, I don't really know much of the history. I know they had a drummer, but he like filled in and he had to like, he wasn't always there, but he was a good drummer, of course, but something just didn't pan out. So now I know with the lineup we have, we're all fully invested and it's all actually full. And now he's able to like get those images out of his head and like get me to vocalize certain things and be dark, be heavy, be light, be, you know, it's like we're painting a painting without a specific color that he asked for. And now he has the color. Now he can create the image that he's thinking of.
Has there been discussed to go back in and maybe throw some vocals over the earlier stuff? Or is that just going to be instrumental?
Yes. I mean, there's a combination of songs that on that record, you know, he worked with Keith in the past. And I know there's some songs that are all Wes. There's some songs that are a mixture and yada, yada, yada. But for instance, Colony, I believe, is an all Wes song. And that's like one of the, I guess, the fan favorites of that era. And we were thinking about putting something on it, but time will tell. Right now, we're going to grind this record into the ground and make sure everybody hears it. But, you know, I think in the next coming months, maybe towards the end of the year, I know there's talks of EPs, there's talks of everything, but like, we just got to see. We got to see where the road takes us at this point. Like, we want a tour. It's all about like, all right, what's the next focus? If we can't get tours, you'll get other stuff soon.
And I think you're one of the best vocalists around, dude. No shit.
Appreciate that.
Like, I've seen all your stuff, and I think you're just phenomenal. And, you know, I like how you seem to be pushing your voice in new areas, which isn't easy to do. I mean, especially if you've been doing it for a while, you know, it can be difficult. But have you found experimenting with your voice and certain ways that you've had to take a step back and relearn how you've done things previously to adapt that into your style now?
Not so much. I feel like it's just like a tone difference. Like in Suffo's case, like I, you know, heavy, just not giving a shit, cupping the mic and gutturals and going low. And like, you know, the fun fact of old Suffo songs, half the songs of the old 90s era doesn't even really have lyrics. They're half sounds, like a lot of the Effigy album. That's just what they did back then. Old Obituary, dude. There's old songs that just don't have lyrics. You know, it's all that crazy shit. And like, you just have fun with it, dude. And like, there's something I say all the time. Like, it's death metal, dude. There's no rules. Do what you want. Make it sound sick. You want to, you know, that's where you see all these kids now doing deathcore and like wind tunnel vocals and, you know, different tongue exercises. And that people ask me, like, what technique are you using? I'm like, I don't know, man. I yell into the thing. And if it sounds cool for me, like I like it, you know, I've always just been inspired by more power forward vocalists. Like there's a hardcore band called Built Upon Frustration that I've been listening to for years. And, you know, Jason is one of the most fierce. It's like if this man, every song I imagine, he's grabbing you like this, screaming in your face. And it's just the most pissed off. And then in terms of gutturals, you have John Gallagher and Fetus, and then you got, you know, Corpse Grinder and Cannibal Corpse, like just all, like that. Those are guys that are just power first. And then tone, you can always pivot after the fact, like so, you know, whatever. Yeah, yeah. But it's power first. And I think for me in this band, I'm not compromising any power that I would have given any other band. It's just tone difference, different, I guess, tongue patterns to get lower and higher and stuff like that. But yeah, as long as it's power first, I'm still with it.
See, I'm learning all that now. Even after like 20 years, I'm learning different stuff.
Yeah. There's always new stuff to learn, dude. Everyone's voice is not meant to do this. So it's like, if you have like, that's like talking to somebody cracks their jaw a different way that you'd ever, it's not possible for you because your whole face makeup is different. So like, I feel like for vocals, it's the same thing. You don't know what it can do until you push it to that limit. You know, it's a muscle. You got to keep working it and practicing with it to make sure you know the sound you can provide. Like, I'm not going to turn around and start doing like stupid low, like, you know, crazy decibel breaking lows. But as long as it sounds strong to me, I'm good. You know, I don't, you know, I'm not trying to sound like everyone else. I like that I, in all this, I do sound like myself.
You do.
And that's something that keeps me going.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I mean, you've got, several different projects to my understanding, and you've got obviously the Merciless Concept as well. What's going on mm-hmm. with that at the moment?
Merciless Concept, we're in the current writing process. Like, we put out an album in October. We self-released it. We didn't get a lot of light on it because it's just, again, it's so hard to put it out yourself. And, we were always just like an East Coast band. We always got to play Jersey and, Philly and Long Island and the city. And we kind of just stayed in that area, but we got some good shows and it was a lot of fun, but who knows where everything can take us. I know Charlie's been busy with Suffo. They're trying to write right now.
Yeah.
We kind of had like a hiatus for a bit where our guitarist, Matt, he's been busy with work and everything else. And he played in a band, Dehumanized, when they were active. Our drummer plays in Sworn Enemy. Taekwon, shout out to the boy. And we got our new bassist, Andrew. And we're, he's going through a thing where he's moving. His family's moving. That's where we practice. So it's like, there's always like if we're a bicycle, there's always a stick getting rammed in our rim. There's always something new that keeps tripping us up. And right now I think it's just, and I keep thinking we should be writing that way. When the time comes, we have an album ready, an EP ready, just something to keep the internet fed, because I feel like we put out an album in October. We don't really have means to market it, a label that's helping out. So it's just kind of like it's sitting on Spotify if you want to check it out. We're reprinting it soon, but everything's all DIY in this operation. So
the interesting thing about that, though, is you've just released Sarcoma.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of people will probably, they're discovering the band, everything like that. And what happens with that usually is they'll dig through other members' stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
Man, I reckon you'll probably find that, very soon.
That'd be great. That'd be absolutely great. I'm all about that natural growth. It's just, paying for a Facebook ad just hurts your spine, dude. It's just
it cripples you.
It's like, I know myself. I don't click any of those. I'm not like, I see it. I scroll faster.
Yeah. That's it. Yeah, I know.
Yeah,
that.
Sponsored advertisements. Great. That's what I want. Yeah. And then now it's funny. I get like sponsored ads from like, it'll be like a local hip hop kid that just did something on GarageBand. He's like on a webcam, like, what's up, man? And it's like, why is this here?
Yeah,
like, and what part of the algorithm said I like this? Interesting.
Don't get me started on the algorithm, man.
I know. Don't get me started.
And people tagging, man, they'll be like, this is what I had for breakfast. And then like they'll tag like 40 people in that. Don't do that.
Oh, yeah.
Don't fucking do that. But I love you guys that do, but please stop.
Yeah. I love checking out new bands. That doesn't mean I want to hear every band. I want to dig through stuff I like. And I get a lot of like Facebook ads from like kids in Indonesia. And I love when like they add me and stuff. But then, dude, it becomes a point where my whole news feed's in a different language that I can't read. And everybody's tagging me in a band that I like nothing is comprehensible in it. And it's like, please like it. Please check it out. I'm flattered.
Yeah, yeah.
But I can't keep up. There's so many. Like right now, if I were to go through my Facebook, I'm sure it'd be just like a crazy world.
Face. You'll see my face in there.
It's wild.
That's fine, dude. What were we talking about? Of course. I mean, you're doing the whole Twitch thing.
Yeah. Twitch has been cool for me, man. It's been my thing that gets me through the pandemic and got me through. Like I left Suffo and just started streaming because I'm a PC gamer through and through. I've been playing games like Counter-Strike and horror games. And now I'm starting to delve into like actually performing what we're doing now that I have something to promote. I hated when it was like, yeah, we got a 2012 demo of Merciless. We got three songs. I will do those three songs on repeat, where I mean, I have a Suffo catalog and stuff like that, but I never really dove into it down. Now I got like a cool team behind me. I got my manager buddy, Kerry. He's been helping me out with my schedule. We're going to be doing podcast interviews. I'm going to eventually make a podcast after all this. I'm inspired by like comedy podcasts and just me. I'm not a serious guy. I'm very sarcastic. So I just know that I can't, it's going to be unfiltered. It's going to be funny. And just, I'm trying to get that going. And the Twitch the in between.
I think you've got such a great personality and talking and you got that conversation. Len, see,
someone just followed me
and you just got the lights going on. See what I mean? I think you should totally go down that road and do the podcasting thing. But how do you find that the whole, because I'm an old man,
How old are you?
I'm 40 this year.
Are you really? You look way younger.
Yeah, I'm a grandfather as well, by the way.
Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, I know, right? But but here's the thing. The Twitch and the Bitcoin and the whole thing, it confuses the fuck out of me, man. So
well,
I just
Twitch is
metal and, but you know.
Twitch is interesting because like there was a big polar shift that happened in Twitch, because in the beginning, I've been on it for 3.5 years, almost four now, I think. But like, dude, I was playing like PUBG to like three kids, you know, like it was like, you're playing a nobody. And it's just, if someone catches something you're interested in, then they're going to stick around. Like I would always blast death metal. I'm listening to like Internal Bleeding or something. And one kid would trickle upon and be like, is that Internal Bleeding right here? I'm like, yeah, this, you know, the homies. And then we just get to talking for 8 hours, me and this one viewer. You know, but now it's become something where I get like 20, 30 kids in there hanging out, and it's, we have a lot of fun, a lot of inside jokes, a lot of memes. And I'm just trying to take that now and evolve it. So like Alluvial's going to be playing live shows soon. I'm going to set up a live rig right behind us. That way you get a back behind the scenes look, green rooms and bus rides and, you know, all that shit. I can't wait to just be like, you know, waking Wes up in the bed, like, hey, well, they're looking at you. Just little stupid shit. You know, it's fun. You know, but awesome. Yeah, follow me on there, twitch.tv/KevMuller.
Love the links. But yeah. Dude, that's awesome. Yeah, I mean, you're talking about hitting the road. Have dates been locked in? Is Australia on there?
Can't say anything yet. We got some stuff in booking, but like stuff, you know, it stuff for this year, but we gotta I don't know when the people want to promote it yet, but we got a one cool rig that's coming up, and I can't wait to tell everybody about it. And it's pretty cool for our first run. I'm excited. I don't know if anything comes sooner or later after that, but we'll see. Just stay, follow Alluvial on Instagram. Follow me on Instagram, and you'll hear about it first.
Have you ever toured down here in Australia? Have you ever been?
No, never been to Australia or Japan. I've toured a lot with Suffo. I did all of Europe. I did South America. I've done Canada and the States a few times. I've never been past a certain point.
Mate,
I can't wait.
You got to come down here and drink some beers. And see the kangaroos in our driveway.
Hell yeah.
Trying to fuck off out of the way.
I have a question for you. Did you have any specific feeling when the Putrid Sunrise started? Do you notice the lyric there?
The what, sorry?
The lyric, the opening lyric of the Putrid Sunrise is fucking oath.
I didn't notice, but now I'm going to have to, yeah.
Yeah, it's just cheers, but
that's
just
a very Australian thing.
Yeah. So that was something that we were just like, fuck it. Let's just party it out. The whole song is about just getting ripped with your friends. But then the progression of the song is how it eats you alive. So it's just like a pro party song. And then the worriness of party songs. So
maybe cool. I can't believe I missed that.
I mean, yeah, it starts. It's the punk one track. It's the Putrid Sunrise.
But like that lyric, that is very Australian.
Very, very.
And we say the C word a lot down here too.
Oh yeah. I love it. It's fun as fuck to say. It just rips. It hits the muscle that you want it to hit, you know?
Well, you could say it three different ways here. You know, there's the
hard T at the end.
Yeah, that's right. That means you say it just the word on its own. It's
yeah.
That guy's a.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
And then you go, he's a mad.
And that's a compliment. That's a pat on the back.
That's it. And you go, that guy's a sick. And yeah. it's a next level altogether.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. It's interesting. Like that's like, I guess that's fuck for us though. You're a sick fuck, you know, or like, you know, get fucked, you know, there's a, you know, all over the place.
Oh mate, that's awesome. Well, dude, it's been cool hanging out with you.
Dude, absolutely. Pleasure's all mine.
Yeah. Well, of course the new album Sarcoma is out now everywhere and it's smashing the charts. We'll have the links down here. Brother, we'll keep the beers nice and cold for you. And
absolutely, bro. I'll be down to party as soon as I get there.
All right, man. Well,
all right.